Hare Krishna. It's today morning. We are at a transition in the Srimad Bhagavatam where Prahlad's prayers to Lord Narasimhadev, which are among the longer, we can call the longest prayers in the Bhagavatam and also among the most important prayers, they have just concluded. And the Lord is responding. So the Lord will speak, Lord Narasimhadev will speak a few verses, and in the next chapter we will have Prahlad also responding. So here, what does the Lord say? That, oh Prahlad, I am pleased with you, ask for benedictions. So I'll speak today on the theme of what is the role of human desire in the divine relationship. When we relate with God, what is the role of our desires in it? At one level, we say that we just surrender and we do God's will. That's true. So I'll talk about this in three broad parts. First is, you know, how our desires normally act. Then, how we look at the desires of the pure devotees act. And we can then think about how our desires can be harmonized with the way the desires of the pure devotees are. So the Lord over here is saying that I like to fulfill the desires. It's my pastime, as Srila Prabhupada translates it. So, and he is not using any devotee specific word. Kama puro smyaham nrunam. Kama puro. I like to fulfill the desires of nrunam, of people in general. And especially, because you have pleased me now, so I want to fulfill your desires. So, for all of us, even a little experience of life helps us understand that the fulfillment of our desires requires something beyond us to work. Right from infancy, when a baby starts crying because it wants food, then the mother may come running and give food, but sometimes the mother may not come. So, when we have a particular desire, any desire, the understanding which we soon get is, it depends on something beyond me. Now that something beyond is in some ways controllable by us. Say, maybe may cry very loudly and the mother comes running. Maybe the promptness with which the mother comes running is proportional to the volume of the baby's cry. And once the baby understands that, then the volume goes up. Sometimes in a class you may see, a baby is so small, we wonder how such a loud noise can come with a small baby. But, so we all try to leverage whatever control we have. To try to get whatever is beyond us to work in a way that it fulfills our desires. And if we evolve spiritually, say later on, if somebody is a part of a country and they are agitating against the government. So right now in Singapore, for example, huge agitation is happening against a particular rule that the government wants to impose. So then there they are agitating. So again, there is people who want some desire and there's something agency outside them. So we try to find out some way in which we can control that which is outside us so that the desire can be fulfilled for us. And this same principle goes forward when it extends whatever is outside there. If you understand, ultimately it's under the control of God. So then there is religion. Now, a cynical way of looking at religion is that it is just a delusion. That actually there is no God up there, but you people have imagined something like that. And that's so that you can have some comfort, you can have some peace. So now, if as is famously said by Marx, religion is the opium of the masses. Now, if religion is the opium of the masses, then irreligion is the heroin of the masses. Why? Because essentially, The idea is that everybody, even the communists, Marx was a communist, he was having this idea that because people believe that there is some religion and there is some God up there, that's why they accept life's unfair situations passively. But once, there is no God up there, there is no other world anywhere, and then the only hope for improvement is in this world by our endeavor. Then people will become more active. So, but the idea that we are not accountable for our actions, the idea that there is nothing beyond this world, can also comfort people who are living in ways that are hurtful for others. Just as the idea that there is a world beyond can comfort some people, the idea that there is no world beyond can also comfort some people. So, if we are only talking in terms of the psychological effect of certain belief systems, the sword cuts both ways. So, what applies for theism also can apply for atheism. But if you see, there's this prominent atheist, Richard Dawkins, and if he's asked, there's so much complexity in nature that how evolution could have brought about it is often difficult. And then his response is that evolution is far smarter than you are. If you can't figure out how evolution is, that's what essentially, you could just replace evolution with God and you would have a statement of religious authority. Now, God is smarter than you are. If you can't figure out how God has acted, that's not God's problem, that's your problem. So what has happened? Atheists don't reject faith. They only replace faith. They replace faith in something transcendent by something immanent. And ultimately, we all have certain desires and we all are looking for some means by which we can fulfill the desires. Now, some means is, as I said, anybody, whether it's theist or atheist, they recognize that the fulfillment of their desires requires the cooperation of factors beyond their control. So, through science, through technology, we try to understand the mechanisms by which nature works. And then we try to use those mechanisms, channel those mechanisms so that they can fulfill our desires. So, if I want to see something entertaining, well, if somebody is performing something entertaining, I can see it. But if there's nothing, then I try to create technology by which I have a television and I can see something entertaining. So basically, when we are trying to fulfill our desires, we want the rest of reality to cooperate. And that rest of reality, how it will cooperate, different people try to gain that leverage, that control by various means. And in a sense, religion and science, by religion I'm talking more about religious rituals, and by science I'm talking about applied science in the form of technology. Both of them are essentially means to fulfill one's desires. People do some religious rituals so that, I can get this, I can get that. I was in a temple in India, the Marathi temple, Hanuman temple. And Hanuman is a celibate, lifelong celibate. And there are lots of people who come and pray to Hanuman, please give me a good spouse. Tum toho bala brahmachari, mujhe de do ek nari. So, they have songs like that. So, the idea is that you're going to God, but that's, you could say it's almost, you're dealing in a, it's manipulating whatever is the higher reality by some means, which we hope it will work. And we get some desire. And if we find that, okay, through technology you can do it, then let's do it through technology. Now, in India, there's a lot of religious piety. So recently, India sent a space mission and it was not as successful as it was hoped for. But this special space mission is, we are using technology to try to gain control, explore, fulfill our desire to know what is out there. But then the ISRO, the Indian Space Research Organization, whenever they have a major space launch, their head goes to the Tirupati Balaji temple. and offers prayers over there. So please let the space launch work. So what you are doing over here? We are integrating science and spirituality. But the purpose is what? To get our desires to be fulfilled. Now, I'm not saying this in any, it's more of objective rather than a critical sense. But the point is, we all have desires and we all look for various ways to fulfill our desires. And here there is an assumption that is rarely examined. And that assumption is that fulfilling our desires will bring fulfillment. That fulfilling our desires will bring fulfillment. This is often an unexamined assumption. You say, obviously, I have a desire, I fulfill it, I'll be happy. Yes, you could say, but we have different levels of desires. I may have a desire, okay, I just want to read the newspaper. I have a desire, I want to eat something. I might get some pleasure, but it is trivial. So, now when we have this idea that I want to fulfill my desires, and if somebody comes to a situation like this where whoever is the deity controlling all of reality, they say, what do you want? I'll give it to you. That would be considered to be a greatly delightful situation to be in. But there are many surveys done. Say, for example, people who win lotteries. On an average, it's like 99% of people who win huge lotteries, 1 year after winning the lottery, they are more unhappy than what they were before winning the lottery. Now, why would that be? Somebody gets a windfall, they have so much money. Money is a resource. Again, money is a resource by which we can fulfill our desires. So the point here is that our happiness, making money is important. But even more important is what we are making with money. What are we using money for? The Shastras say that artha can increase anartha. Or artha can take us to paramartha. Artha is wealth. Artha can increase anartha. Anartha is the lust, anger, greed, envy, pride, illusion. See, somebody is just exploring drugs. Just making of taking a drug, few drugs here and there. And at that time, they get an inheritance from a grandmother. And they get $1 million. Oh, maybe that could be the worst thing that can happen to them. Because now they have as much money as they want to take as much drugs as they want. So artha can lead to anartha. Or artha, if it is used properly, it can lead to paramartha. So we have wealth which has value, but paramartha is transcendence, which is supreme value. So material value can be used to create spiritual value. How is that? Material value means we have something which is materially valuable and we use it in a spiritual way, and that creates spiritual value. So if we look at Prahlad, he was just a small 5-year-old boy, and at one level he had, because he was the son of the person who was ruling the universe, you could see he had a lot of material value, provided he stayed connected and obedient to his father. He gave it all up. He refused it all for the sake of Vishnu. And when he refused it all for the sake of Vishnu, what happened? He was persecuted, he was tormented, he was threatened. And finally, he was delivered. He was saved by Narasimhadev himself. So now, at this stage, there is material value and there is spiritual value. And he rejected material value to stick with spiritual value. And the supreme object of spiritual value, Lord Vishnu, has now appeared before him. So here I am moving on to the second point, that you know, how are the desires of the great devotees? So if you see, Prahlad also prays earlier. He says, my dear Lord, I have seen that although my father had everything, but still, he was not satisfied. He said, Yasmat priya priya viyoga sanyoga janma shokagnina sakalayo nishudhayamana dukkhaushadham tadapi dukkham atadhyaham muman brahmami vadame tavadasya yogam. So, he describes the entirety of material existence and the way out of material existence in this one verse. He says, what is it? Esmat priya priya viyoga sanyoga janma. That we all have certain things which are priya, which are desirable. And sanyoga, we want them. We want union with the desirable. And we want viyoga, separation from the apriya, the undesirable. So we all can think of things. I don't want this to happen and I want this to happen. So, most people are trying to do this. We want union with the desirable and separation from the undesirable. But most of the times, we have union with the undesirable and separation from the desirable. And that's why, Shokagnina sakala yonishudhayamanaha. All living beings are burning in the fire of lamentation. Now we all can think, even from the morning itself, we wake up, maybe the time when we wanted to wake up and the time when we woke up. That frustration begins right from that point. So, what we want to do and what works out, it's so much frustration. So then, he says, that's why everybody is lamenting. But then, he gives a twist in the tale. He says that dukkhaushadham tadapi dukkham. That means, normally, to not get the desirable or to get the undesirable causes distress. But to get the desirable causes greater distress. Dukkha, everybody is in dukkha because they are not getting the priya or they are getting the apriya. But if you get the priya, dukkhaushadham, that dukkha, that distress goes away if you can get the desirable. But dukkhaushadham tadapi dukkham, that also causes distress. The cure for the disease becomes the cause of a greater disease. The cure for distress causes greater distress. And what is the example? Later on, as the prayers of Prahlad evolve, we see that he used the example of his own father, Hiranyakashipu. Brujumbena, he says that my father was so powerful that he didn't even have to express his desire. He just raised his eyebrows and the universal elements would cooperate. It's like now we have this IoT, Internet of Things, where you can just speak to Google, decrease the temperature, and decrease the temperature, maybe from 25 to 23 or whatever, whichever scale, or turn on the fan, increase the AC, whatever. Now, he had, you could say, the even more advanced version of Internet of Things. He didn't even have to speak, and he just had to glance, and it was not just the temperature of his room would decrease, the temperature of the atmosphere would decrease. The gods presiding the cosmos, they would dance to his tune. And yet, what happened? Through it all, he was not happy. He could control the whole universe practically, and yet he was not happy. Why? Bhagavatam says, because he could not control his mind and senses. What does this mean, not control his mind and senses? We say, why does he need to control his mind and senses? See, all of us, we want to follow some dharma, we want to live according to some moral principles. Or, even if we don't want to live according to some moral principles, we have some limitations, because of which we cannot get what we desire. And that's why we need to control our mind and senses. We may crave for this and we may crave for every attractive object, but it will be immoral and it will be also impossible for us to get it. So we need to control ourselves. But if somebody has so much power, then why do they need to control? This is where the Bhagavatam goes deeper. See, the Bhagavatam's mood is to talk about how transcendence is what is most important. And it gives various examples. Generally, say if a person has some minor disease, then if a doctor wants to offer treatment, doctor might offer two trajectories. If you take this treatment, you will get cured and you will become like this. But if you don't take this treatment, this disease will worsen, and then this is what will happen to you. Then the doctor gives a prognosis. So what the Bhagavatam is doing is that at one level it shows us what happens if somebody goes and fulfills all their desires and gets the power to fulfill those desires also. But still it says dukkhaushadham tadapi dukkham. Why? Because we often think that, say, these are the things which I want and which I have, these are things which I don't have. And we think that the more and more things we can have, then more and more we will become happy because we can control and enjoy those things. So most of people's life endeavor is in moving things from the category of what I don't have to what I have. And this is increasing our positions so that we can enjoy our gratification. That is what people are trying to do. But as long as the mind and senses are not controlled, no, what is going to happen is, no matter how much we have, the uncontrolled mind and uncontrolled senses will keep looking at what we don't have. So, the level of our possession doesn't determine our satisfaction. It is the direction of our consciousness. It is our disposition. And that's why in the Bhagavad Gita 17th chapter, when Krishna talks about austerity of the body, mind and speech, he says, in 1716, Manah Prasada Saumyatvam Maunam Atma Vinigraha Bhavasam Shuddhirtyetat Tapomanasam Uchyate. So he says Tapomanasam. Austerity of the mind is to cultivate satisfaction. Most of us think satisfaction is just an emotion. I feel it, I don't feel it. But as Krishna is saying, satisfaction is not just an emotion, it is a cultivation, it is a decision. So we have to make the conscious decision to stop looking at the things that we don't have and look at the things that we have. And that requires control of the mind and senses. If we don't have control of the mind and senses, then we may have far, far more than anyone else in this category of what we have. But still, we will look at what we don't have and we'll not be satisfied. So Prahlad is saying, I saw this and dukkhaushadham tatidapi dukkham. What happened? The more power he got, the more he could fulfill his desires, the more his craving increased, the more his arrogance increased, the more his destructiveness increased, and the more his dissatisfaction increased. So he said he was not satisfied. And therefore the solution is vadame tava dasya yogam. My dear Lord, please instruct me how to practice bhakti yoga, how to serve you. So the devotee recognizes that fulfilling desires is not necessarily the way to fulfillment. Because no matter how many desires we fulfill, there will always be some things which we don't have and we'll keep desiring them and there will be no satisfaction. So then what does a devotee do? We can say that we have many desires and the devotee's first purpose is to purify desires. That impure desires, let them go away. We purify them by connecting with Krishna. That's why we have sadhana. We have the chanting of the holy names, we have the study of scriptures, we have the worship of the deities. By which the desires become purer. The impure desires start going away. And at one level, there is to desire Krishna. And to so basically, this whole class, to summarize, I'll talk in three ways. To desire from Krishna, to desire Krishna and to desire for Krishna. So at the material level, the first part I talk about is a desire from Krishna. Now, people may believe in Krishna, people may believe in some structure of reality out there. What is out there? We desire from that. Give me this, give me this, give me that. Now that is not the path to satisfaction. It'll only lead to frustration. Then bhakti has two aspects to it. To desire Krishna and to desire for Krishna. To desire Krishna means that a devotee just wants to be absorbed in Krishna. Nothing else. I want to remember Krishna, I want to glorify Krishna, and that's all. Absorbed in Krishna. So our sadhana primarily is to cultivate that desire for Krishna. Atchittam samadhatum nashaknosi maistiram abhyasa yoga nidato mamichaptum dhananjaya abhyasa yoga. If you practice sadhana bhakti, Maam Icha, Icha, my desire for him will come. And along with that, there is the desire Krishna. If Prabhupada only desired Krishna, he could have stayed in Vrindavan and he could have been absorbed in Krishna. But Prabhupada didn't just desire Krishna, he desired for Krishna. He desired for Krishna that there'll be temples all over the world. He desired for Krishna that there may be many, many devotees, many, many books written. So, in our life also, does our individual desire have room in bhakti? Yes, it definitely has room. It is not, a pure devotee doesn't mean a pure devotee is desireless. A devotee doesn't so much desire from Krishna like the materialistic people do. But a devotee desires for Krishna. Yashoda Mai desires to cook the best food for Krishna. She wants to get the very best milk and make the very best butter, and she wants to offer it to Krishna. So similarly, for us, the way to deal with desires is, initially, we may come to Krishna to desire from Krishna. And that's fine. But if we get connected with devotees, then we will understand that Krishna is Krishna's greatest blessing. That more than what Krishna gives us, more valuable is if Krishna gives himself to us. And then we start desiring Krishna, or at least following the process to desire Krishna. And we cannot be satisfied simply by just being absorbed in the remembrance of Krishna directly. It's difficult. We also want to do something in the world. So then we desire for Krishna. That desire for Krishna can come either from the instruction of the spiritual master, or it can come from our own heart with the consent or with the blessings of the spiritual master, or it may emerge as an opportunity from a situation. So this whole theme of desire from Krishna, and desire for Krishna, I'll talk about this more in today's Bhagavad Shravan class. But here we see Prahlad desired only Krishna. And what happens? Now Krishna, Lord Narasimha is reciprocating by saying, what do you want to desire from me? What benediction do you want? I want to give that. And Prahlad will say, I don't want anything, my dear Lord. If you want to give me anything, the only desire that I have is that I stop desiring from you. Because I understand you are the supreme desirable object. And of course, then he will ask for the deliverance of his father. And Narasimha Dev will say, he's already delivered, do not worry. But this is the sweet reciprocity. The sweetness of bhakti is not based on the denial of human desire, but it is in the distillation of human desire. When some water is distilled, it becomes pure. So similarly, the process of bhakti distills our desire so that we desire Krishna and desire for Krishna instead of desiring from Krishna. So I'll summarize. I spoke on the topic of what is the role of human desire in the process of bhakti. I started by main part of the class I focused on was how do we deal with desires. We understand right from our child infancy practically that fulfilling our desires requires something beyond us. And we try to manipulate or control that. A baby may cry very loudly. So religious people might perform some rituals. Those who have a lot of faith in science and technology, they might develop technology. So we try to leverage whatever power we have to get reality to cooperate with us to fulfill our desires. And while we are doing this, there is an assumption that fulfilling our desires will lead to fulfillment. And that assumption itself is questionable. Why? Because I talked about we have certain things which we desire, we have many things which we don't desire. No matter if we get more and more desirable things, if our mind and senses are uncontrolled, they'll keep looking at what we don't have and will keep us forever dissatisfied. So the solution is not so much increasing our possession, but changing our disposition. Satisfaction is not just an emotion, but also a decision, a cultivation. And how do we stop looking at all the things that we don't have? If we understand that Krishna is the supreme desirable, everything's attractiveness comes from Krishna, let me desire Krishna. So instead of desiring from Krishna, we start desiring Krishna. And that is sadhana bhakti. And then, while we are desiring Krishna, we also want to serve him and do something for him in this world. So we desire for Krishna. In the world, even if we don't get our desires fulfilled, that's frustrating. But if we get our desires fulfilled, that artha leads to anartha, as happened with Hiranyakashipu, and that leads to greater frustration. So instead, we use our artha, That means we use whatever resources that we have for fulfilling our desires for paramartha. So bhakti gives room for human desire as long as it is in harmony with the divine desire. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Yes,
Prabhu. What if there is a shortage of artha? Should we strive for some artha?
Okay, good question. Should we strive for artha if there is shortage? Yes. See, what we desire for Krishna should not be desired more than Krishna. What we desire for Krishna. Say, we want to build a big temple for Krishna. So we want money. Or we want to do some educational program. So we want people, we want resources. Now, that desire, it's good to have because we can do more service to Krishna. But if that desire becomes stronger than our desire for Krishna, then that desire will consume our consciousness and distract us from Krishna. So we can definitely seek artha, but that desire should not become stronger than our desire for Krishna. Okay, thank you. Anything else? Any comments? Jai Jagannath Prabhu. So thank you very much. Gadraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki Srila Prabhupada ki Jai Gaur Premanande
Chaitanya Charan Prabhu ki
Jai.